for coming. It's this concert is an idea that was sort of germinated last October, and we're doing this for a couple of really good reasons. First is, of course, that this is a fundraiser. We want to generate some money for people for clean water in Mexico. We are such a privileged people. It's a good thing for us to do. That's the first purpose. And the second purpose is to have fun. And we are going to have fun tonight, and I don't know if you are, but we are. I guarantee you that. There's something for everybody tonight. But I'm going to start off this evening with a classical hymn. So, highbrow. I learned this piece when I was a kid. It was as challenging then as it is now. It's very ambitious. I started taking piano lessons when I was 11 years old. And somebody who knew something about music apparently directed me to, or my parents, to a particular piano teacher. Her name was Irene Kolkoma. And this woman just passed away about 2 years ago. But I thought about her throughout my whole adult life. She was a taskmaster. And she was hard on me, and she challenged me. But it never felt critical. It felt affirming. It felt, you can do this. It felt all those good things. So I'm dedicating to her memory, this piece. It's by Brahms. Brahms wrote this piece somewhere around 1880. It's a large piece. In fact, the sheet music says molto passionato, which means much passion. So I'll try to play it with much passion. Brahms also had very big hands, and it's a good piece for me to start with because it'll stretch me out. For those of you that are musical type people, it often goes nine notes, two notes above an octave. So it's a big number. This is Rhapsody in G minor.
Thank you.
She inflicted that upon me at age 14. And the nice thing about this piano teacher of mine, Mrs. Kamani, was that not only did she school me in the classical, but she had enough breadth in her own musical repertoire to introduce different things. So I learned jazz. She introduced me to jazz. She introduced me to the blues. She introduced me to gospel music. I had all these rich experiences under her tutelage. So I thought I'd play a ragtime piece for you. Scott Joplin is sort of the most noteworthy name when it comes to ragtime composers. A lot of people think that ragtime originated around 1930 because those of us that are roughly our age, if you saw the movie The Sting and The Entertainer, you think, well, that was 1930s. But actually, ragtime's first heyday was in around 1880, 1890s, exactly when this last piece I just played was written. And Scott Joplin was the son of a slave. Now, by virtue of the Emancipation Proclamation, slaves were set free, but you can imagine how just, you know, 15, 20 years later in the 1880s, that blacks and people of color were discriminated and marginalized in a huge way. And what happened was there were these sort of party houses and entertainment houses where people of color congregated and felt like they could belong and they could include. And one of those houses was called the Maple Leaf. And hence Scott Joplin's Maple Leaf Rag, which I'm going to play for you right now. Interesting thing about Joplin was he composed this song, but history says he didn't play it because it was too difficult for him. So, kind of interesting little tidbit. This is Maple Leaf Rag. Thank you. Beautiful song. Time now for some oldies. And many of you, when you hear some of these songs, will do the same thing that we've done when we rehearsed them. We're going, oh, I remember that. Man, I was, you know. My wife Linda will say, it was blueberry picking. I'm going to bring on a couple of guys that have a couple things in common with me. First of all, great love of music. And secondly, both alumni of a certain college downstream. The first man is a director of music at Bellevista Church, actually, in the North End, and a guitarist extraordinaire. Give a nice warm welcome, would you please, to Mr. Pete Bardoff. And secondly, another Calvin alum, entertainer, singer, guitarist, please welcome Mr. Glenn Wolthuis.
Oh, Door, 5 Hour, Eagles, Beatles, Bee Gees, Johnny Osmond Fest. Well, the next song, actually a Beatles tune, but I was doing some research. You know, this is a thoughtful crowd here. You want to have not just, you know, humor, but you want to have facts. But this next song is, you know, when the Beatles came to the U.S. in 1964, February, they were on Ed Sullivan. They did "I Want to Hold Your Hand" and "She Loves You" and "All My Loving." But the month before, in January, they were playing a 2-week stint in Paris at the Olympic. And during that time, they recorded this next song in Paris. So it's the only Beatles song not recorded in England. So there you go. The only one ever not recorded in England.
I did not know that.
So you ready for this one? Yeah. You guys ready for it?
Look out, baby.
working with people that not only are they fantastic musicians, but even better people. And on vocals, next to Leslie, is a woman with a great voice of her own, great singer, happens to be the worship director here at this church, Miss Janet Coyle. And way back there in the corner, we usually have a sign on the plexiglass that says, please don't feed the animals. A singer, fantastic singer in his own right, but today, resident percussionist, please welcome Mr. Marty Wunderjohn.
Desperado, why?
this number, and we're going to take a 5-minute break while you listen to how important this cause is. About 5 minutes, we'll be back. Shout out to people. Who likes that song? Yeah, close your hands.
You can do this.
Shower of the People is off an album called In the Pocket. It came out in 1976, so just think back where you were in 1976. Somewhere you weren't just a glimmer in your parents' eyes, I love that boy. Well, you can play the game, then you can knock out the part, but you know it wasn't written for you. But tell me, how can you stand there with your broken heart? Shame of playing the fool. One thing can lead to another. It doesn't take any sacrifice. Oh, father and mother, sister and brother, if it feels nice, don't think twice. Shower the people you love with love. Show them the way. Show them the way that
Did you know that Calvinists could be so much fun? Thank you, guys. And thank you for coming. I'm Tom Griggs from the water team here at Fifth. And we have a special guest this evening, came from Mexico, Maria Fritz. As many of you know, Fifth has been sending short-term mission teams down for about 15 years to work among the Mayan Indians in the Yucatan Peninsula. Maria orchestrated those trips and has a real passion for our brothers and sisters, the Mayans. About 5-6 years ago, we started the water project because we were seeing a lot of dysentery and intestinal parasites in villages. And Maria was instrumental in picking the village. And I'd like her to share with you some of the impact of the water filter projects.
Again, thank you for being here in support of this benefit and this wonderful music. As Tom said, I've been involved in missions for 25 years. I went on my first medical mission 25 years ago and just absolutely fell in love with the project. The idea of serving the least of his children has become near and dear to my heart. And now I'm just thrilled to be here representing the pastor in Mexico, in the Yucatan, through whom all these filters have been donated and installed in the neediest of the villages and the churches, in the homes of the people that need it the most. The water team identified the need for clean water many years ago and decided that instead of treating parasites and worms and all those kinds of things, maybe we could, or they could, do something about the water, that they could improve their physical health. Well, through this work and through the work of Pastor Eduardo Ayala, whom this church supports, that work of providing clean water has opened the doors for him to share the message of salvation with so many people. People used to be afraid, perhaps, of what his church represented or what his ministry represented. But after they have seen the work and his interest and commitment to serving their physical needs, that has opened the door for him. He doesn't even have to go knocking on doors anymore. People come to him to ask what his ministry is all about, what the water projects are all about. And currently, I know through the water filters, he estimates about 600 people have been directly direct beneficiaries of the clean water supply through the churches and through the individual filters that have been installed in the homes. But the impact community-wide has just been tremendous. And there's it would be hard to estimate how many people are being impacted by that. He has had the opportunity to start small group Bible studies in different communities. He currently is involved in a discipleship program where he is being empowered to train 42 of his peers to make disciples. So the project is exploding, so to speak. And praise God for all the work that has come about through the clean water projects. So this church has been tremendous in terms of providing prayers and resources, your presence there for so many of you that have participated down there. You could see from some of the pictures how really poor they are, how much they lack by way of worldly goods. I could say the same thing about Pastor Ayala and his family. He is not a wealthy person, and yet he's committed to serving the least of his children. And it's such an inspiration. I know, I think it's one of the things that keeps me going back time and again. I need to, a reality check, so to speak. We are so blessed here in the United States, and we certainly are privileged to have clean water in abundance and so many of the blessings that they lack. And so it keeps me going back, and it keeps me focused in understanding that God has blessed us so we could be a blessing to others. So I would encourage your generous support of this program, which is ongoing. Tom and I were talking, and when they were only doing medical work, they had an average of 10 participants per trip, and now we're approaching 20 soon of participants that are involved in this kind of work, which is absolutely tremendous. Pastor Ayala was invited by the church to come and be here with you tonight, and it would be, it couldn't happen this year, but hopefully maybe in the next year or so, so that you can meet him in person. He's a person that, even though he doesn't speak English, you can immediately tell that his love for the Lord and his love for serving the people. So hopefully you'll have that opportunity to meet him in the future. And it's just exciting how the Clean Water Project is really so much more than that. And it is bringing spiritual health to so many in the Yucatan. So thank you for your support. Thank you for being here tonight.
Thanks Maria. We will be collecting an offering at the doors. If you want to write a large check, you can make it out to Fifth Reformed Church and just put water on the little memo line. The cost of a filter for a village, which is good for most any site church in these little villages, but at least 100 families, is $6,000, which is pretty reasonable. The cost to support Pastor Eduardo for a year as a full-time missionary is $5,000. So you get a lot of bang for your buck down in Mexico. We'll have people milling around with these crazy looking sombreros on. If you have questions about the project, if you have interest, you can come to church here tomorrow morning, and Maria will be speaking at Sunday school or talk to us at the hub there. So again, thank you very much, and let's applaud the band back on stage.
So as you walk in the door, there's a guy you're going, because you know there's two different sides of stands. You know, he's going Christians, Catholics. I felt like I was in purgatory. Well, you know, you've probably heard of the Chicago Blues, the Delta Blues, the New Orleans Blues, but very few people tell about or sing about the Dutch Blues. I suspect in this room tonight there are a lot of people who, if they don't have the Dutch Blues, they may have in the past had the Dutch Blues, or maybe in the future have the Dutch Blues. And it's kind of a funny kind of blues. It's kind of a Delft colored kind of blues. You know, Randy here, he's a psychologist. He spends 40 hours a week just dealing with the Dutch blues, don't you? And you know, it's funny because people don't talk about it, but I think we need to have a national conversation about the Dutch blues. I really do. So I wrote the White House, and Al Sharpton's coming down. So for the next 18 minutes, I will present for you, actually not 18, it'll be slightly less than that. Depending on you, actually, it depends on the word. I present to you the Dutch Blues.
Thank you.
get an education, go back home to LA. Move up here a couple years later, marry yourself a nice little Dutch girl, born and raised in the CRC, something like the RCA. Two church services on Sunday, catechism every Wednesday night, bar mitzvah on Friday. Nobody leaves a boy that kind of man can possibly sing, can possibly speak.
Don't let me get alone. playing guitar, and a lot of guitar heroes appeared on the scene, and some one felt one could emulate, and others not so much. But again, a band came around one of those years called Dire Straits, and a guitar player by the name of Mark Knopfler, who wrote and sang most of the songs and played the guitar, and you know, he played a nice, graceful guitar style, and his vocals never went real high pitch, and he didn't have lots of hair, and I thought, here's a role model I could get behind. So my little part of the show here is a tune by Dire Straits. This is kind of their first song that got them on the map. It's called Sultans of Swing.
Thank you.
get a little tired. I am, like many of you, several I'm sure, maybe many of you gentlemen out there, blessed to be married to a phenomenal woman. Linda's her name. She's here with us. I just hope she's here 4 minutes from now. This woman has put me through 6 years of graduate school years ago, cared for me, loved me, encouraged me, and yes, tolerated me. We went to the same high school, but we didn't meet until we were in our senior year at a high school in Muskegon called Western Mission Christian High School. Yeah. Draw attention to the fight song. That's when we met, and was smitten instantly. And I thought, here's a song I've been thinking about for literally decades, and I finally have the venue to do it. So, I'll tell you a little story about how this happened.
Musical band people, they have been absolutely outstanding. Wouldn't you agree?
time to get out of here. Let's travel on.
Get her.